morning and welcome to worship. Today is Sunday, January 31st. We were supposed to be here meeting together in our sanctuary this morning, but the anticipated snow has caused us to push that back 1 week. So next week, the first Sunday in February, we will plan on meeting here. We will have our precautions. Please contact me for a reservation. We'll wear our masks and be socially distant. And immediately following the service, we will have our annual meeting. You should have received those materials in the mail. In Deuteronomy, God promises to raise up a prophet like Moses who will speak for God. In Psalm 111, God shows the people the power of God's works. For the church, these are ways of pointing to the unique authority people sensed in Jesus' actions and words. We encounter that authority in God's word, around which we gather, the word that prevails over any lesser spirit that would claim power over us, freeing us to follow Jesus. We gather in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them his Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, be with you. Let us pray. Compassionate God, you gather the whole universe into your radiant presence and continually reveal your Son as our Savior. Bring wholeness to all that is broken and speak truth to us in our confusion, that all creation will see and know your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The first reading for this, the fourth Sunday in the Epiphany season, is taken from the book of Deuteronomy, the 18th chapter. Moses said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, 'If I hear the voice of the Lord my God anymore or ever again see this great fire, I will die.' Then the Lord replied to me, 'They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among your own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die.'" Here ends our first reading. Our second reading comes from Psalm 111. Hallelujah! I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly of the upright, in the congregation. Great are your works, O Lord, pondered by all who delight in them. Majesty and splendor mark your deeds, and your righteousness endures forever. You cause your wonders to be remembered. You are gracious and full of compassion. You give food to those who fear you, remembering forever your covenant. You have shown your people the power of your works in giving them the lands of the nations. The works of your hand are faithfulness and justice. All your precepts are sure. They stand fast forever because they are done in truth and equity. You sent redemption to your people and commanded your covenant forever. Holy and awesome is your name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who practice this have a good understanding. God's praise endures forever. Here ends our second reading. Thank you. Holy Gospel comes from the Gospel of St. Mark, the first chapter beginning with the 21st verse. Jesus and his disciples went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, not as the scribes. Just then there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this, a new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the regions of Galilee. Here ends our gospel reading. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. I have been very humbled and appreciative to have received both doses of the COVID-19 vaccine because of my work in the hospital. I'm very grateful for this and understand that it's not most people's experience. And I also feel a certain responsibility to share my experience because I do feel it's important for as many people as possible. And I know that there is some fear and apprehension in taking a vaccine like this. Today, I want to give a shout out to a special group of heroes, those who moved beyond fear to trust in science and risk their own health to test these COVID-19 vaccines beginning last fall. Among those who stepped forward was a group of African Americans who volunteered to contribute to inclusivity and better representation. Now, I understand that it's especially hard for Blacks, Latinos, and other minorities to trust in what they see our government programs. There are always reasons to be skeptical. Minorities have experienced more than their share of broken promises from the government. And there, of course, was the horror of the unethical Tuskegee syphilis study, which used African-American sharecroppers as human guinea pigs. The government later admitted to a 40-year racist diabolical experiment that had lingering effects. So there's lots of reasons not to step forward, and yet there were some key African-Americans who stepped forward to participate in this study. One was a man named Chris Harris from the Cleveland area. His young son had a bout with COVID-19, and it incited him to participate in the University Hospital of Cleveland's trial of the Pfizer vaccine. He said, "This was an opportunity being a minority, knowing that our community has been hit particularly hard by COVID-19. I wanted to be an example and really be on the front line of something that could turn out to be very beneficial." Now, at the time, he says, many in his life were skeptical. They were afraid. They were even discouraging. I received a lot of pushback, a lot of, "Are you sure about this?" from family and from friends. But it was important for him to still go forward with this trial. He said, "I just felt in my gut that it was the right thing to do, not just for myself, but also for the community in general." And once the vaccine was approved, he learned that he did receive the approved vaccine, not a placebo. He said those skeptics were both proud and grateful. Two other people, Dr. Margaret Larkins Pettigrew and her husband, Dr. Chenis Pettigrew, both African American, they also participated in that trial. "I stepped up and took my place in line," Dr. Pettigrew said. For them, it was also about inclusion. "I want to know what's best for African Americans and people of color when it comes to treatment regimens. And I wanted other people to understand that we shouldn't fear the vaccines," Dr. Larkins Pettigrew said. Dr. Pettigrew got the vaccine during the trial. She is relieved and looking forward to seeing her kids and grandkids safely again. She said, "I was excited that I got it and that I didn't have any reactions to it besides a sore arm. And I can tell people that story. Our friends ask all the time, I'm thinking about it. I'm on the fence," she said. Harris says everyone has the right to make the choice that's best for them, but he invites people to do some research. He says, talk to your healthcare provider. Talk to someone who's obtained the vaccine. Ask questions. Those kinds of things are going to help you make the best informed decision for yourself and for your family. We're all in this together, and if we don't all participate, then we're never going to get to that point where we'll have some level of normalcy anymore. What a wonderful witness of someone willing to step forward with courage, perhaps with some apprehension and fear, but also trust and a belief in the greater good. Faith and trust in God allow us to move beyond fear. But here's the thing, fear itself is not a bad thing in and of itself. More on that in a moment. Today I'd like us to focus on our Psalm 111, which gives a blueprint for happiness. It talks about giving thanks with our whole heart because of God's great deeds and marvelous works. It talks about what God stands for: graciousness, compassion, faithfulness, justice, truth, equity, redemption, taking what is bad and bringing good out of it. So far, so good. And then comes this interesting phrase: the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who practice this have a good understanding. I mean, doesn't that phrase just come smack up against our religious sensibilities? Don't we believe in a kinder, gentler God? What does it mean to fear God? When we baptize children, we pray that God would pour his Spirit upon them and give them these seven gifts: the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, and the Spirit of joy in God's presence. What is this fear of the Lord? Well, I think this sense of fear has to do with respect, honor, acknowledging what truly has power. We usually think about being disabled by fear, being so afraid that we can't move or talk or think. But what if we were empowered by fear? Martin Luther wrote, "Being afraid of God is different from fearing God. The fear of God is the fruit of love, but being afraid of him is the seed of hatred. Therefore, we should not be afraid of God, but we should fear him so that we do not hate him whom we should love. Therefore, the fear of God is more aptly called reverence," Luther says. For example, he goes on, "We fear those whom we love, we honor, esteem, and fear to offend," end quote. In Luther's time, the problem with being afraid of God was that people lived in fear of their mortal soul. They were always living in terror. And of course, that's not our problem anymore. Perhaps fear of God has to do with the phrase, "Hallowed be thy name," in the Lord's Prayer. We pray, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." What does it mean, though, to hallow God's name? Hallow is not a word that we use over the breakfast table or in our backyard. It's not a common word at all to us. Working with a group of second graders once upon a time, I remember they used the phrase, "Hallowed be thy name." What would it mean for God's name to be hallowed? Well, that's a whole nother sermon, isn't it? Now, there may be some truth in their slip, though, too, because the word hallow is, I think, hollow to us. It seems empty. But let's take a closer look. Webster's defines hallowed as to set apart as sacred. And that makes sense. God should be set apart, seen as something completely different from any person or force on earth. Sacred, given a respect in a very particular way. And this reverence towards God is called upon throughout Scripture and certainly found in Jesus' own words. In Matthew 22, when the Pharisees asked Jesus, "Which is the greatest commandment?" He replied to them that we are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That's what it means to hallow God's name. Now, getting back to the Lord's Prayer, there are two parts to the petition of the Lord's Prayer. First in the prayer is the hope that we might hallow God's name, that all might call Jesus Lord and follow his authority. Second, though, our prayer is a declaration of our desire to hallow God's name in our lives, and that can be tough to do. I know it is for me. What does that mean? Why should we hallow God's name? Well, first, because God created all things and has given us everything that we have. And God cared enough for us to not just leave us on our own, separated from our Creator and from each other. God came down to us in the form of Jesus in order to love us, to bridge this gap which had occurred between us and God. God is great, mysterious, powerful, and also familiar and personal, so personal that we can even call God Father. And that's why we hallow God's name. We hallow or fear God because of the authority of Jesus. In our gospel lesson today, we hear about his teaching. They were astonished at his teaching, for he taught as one who had authority and not as their scribes. We hear about his healing, his authority over unclean spirits. And we know of his authority even unto and beyond death. But it's more than that. If it were just lessons in ancient history, it wouldn't be enough. But these things that we believe about God are not just a bunch of old stories. We say that God is loving because we have experienced it. We say that God is forgiving and can bring peace because we have experienced that too, because we know God. That's important. To truly be able to hallow God's name, we have to develop a relationship with God. Just like any other relationship, it involves communication, trust, and a lot of time together to really get to know each other. And through that hallowing, that fear of God, we can find comfort from others, from other fears that plague us. Someone once said, "We crucify ourselves between two thieves, regret for yesterday and fear of tomorrow." How many of us are trapped by those two thieves that steal away life, abundant life? We turn over our anxieties, our worries, our wisdom, and our efforts to the one who has ultimate authority. Getting back to the vaccine, I understand people are apprehensive and have fear and have questions, and perhaps some of those will be addressed and raised over time. All I can do is witness to what I've experienced, which I believe is a good thing, and I encourage you to experience the same as I have. That's really the key to our faith. As we look beyond our fears, as we place our trust in a God who ultimately loves and will care for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. let us confess our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and was born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For all who share the gospel and proclaim freedom in Christ throughout the world, prophets, teachers, pastors, deacons, and lay leaders, for the church and its ministries, Lord, in your mercy, we pray to you. For all God's works in creation, plants and animals, water and soil, forests and farms, and for those tasked with protecting our natural resources and all that exists, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For government and leaders, cities and nations, rescue professionals and legal aid attorneys, elected officials and grassroots organizers, for all responsible for the well-being of civil society, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who suffer in mind, body, and spirit, those who are sick and hospitalized, those living with HIV and AIDS, those struggling with mental illness, those who are hungry or homeless, and all in any need. We pray especially for you, to you today, for Dorothy Douglas, Ed and Betty Nelson, for Ken Nelson, all those battling cancer, for all COVID patients, especially Sharon and Colin Morrison as they recover, Red Nelson and Tim Hazelton. We want to pray for Skip Feld, Ken Endress' brother-in-law, who's hospitalized on a ventilator in Youngstown, Ohio. We also pray for Ken's sister, Kathy Lynn, for calm and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the concerns of this congregation, for those who travel, those who are isolated at home, those celebrating birthdays or anniversaries, especially we remember this week, Jerry Holmes and Nancy Bierstedt and Kingston Cole. For those celebrating anniversaries or other significant life events, for the people of God in this place and for other needs in our community, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for our elected leaders, especially today we pray for President Joseph Biden, for Vice President Kamala Harris. We pray for all our senators, those in Congress. We pray, Lord, that you would lead their ways and keep them safe. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. now may God, the Creator, strengthen you, Jesus, the Beloved, fill you, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.